Friends, the Four Noble Truth, Tathagata Arya Satyani, which is the very core of Buddhism, are: 1. All this and such is suffering, dukkha. 2. Craving is the cause of suffering, dukkha samudaya. 3. Absence of all craving is the end of suffering, dukkha nirodho. 4. The Noble Eightfold Way, leading to the end of suffering, dukkha nirodha, kama nipatipada. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nibbana is simply this: right view, sammaditti; right motivation, samma sankappa; right speech, samma vacca; right action, samma kammanta; right livelihood, samma ajiva; right effort, samma vajjama; right awareness, samma sati; and right concentration, samma samadhi. What is right motivation? What is this vital right motivation? Right motivation is triple. 1. The motivation for withdrawal, nekamma, is being motivated by a general absence of greed, craving and desire. Being motivated by a generous giving, relinquishing all possessiveness. Being motivated by detachment from the five sense desires of urge for alluring, captivating and tempting sights, sounds, smells, tastes and touches. Being motivated for cutting attachment, clinging to these five clusters of clinging, to all forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions and consciousness. Such radical renunciation is right motivation. Two, the motivation for non-ill will, which is the same as friendly goodwill, is being motivated by universal friendliness, infinite goodwill, kind care, non-anger, non-hate, non-aversion, and a sympathy, well-wishing, and working for all sentient beings' happiness, contentment, comfort, benefit and welfare. Such gentle, active kindness is right motivation. 3. The motivation for total non-violence, absolute harmlessness, is being motivated by absolute non-violence, by absence of all cruelty, and by presence, continuous presence of compassionate pity, thereby offering all sentient beings guaranteed safety and protection from any evil, painful, bad, or wrong treatment. Such offer a full protective fearlessness to all beings is right motivation. The opposites of these advantageous intentions are wrong motivation. Right motivation Samma Sankappa is enunciated in Majjhima Nikaya number 117, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha number 117, the Maha Chatta Risakha Sutta, the Discourse on the Great 40. This and such is right motivation. Thank you for your attention, your keen attention, and have a nice day.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 65. Back under the tree, out in the open, a little windy, a little cloudy, but nevertheless, out in the free open. There are three questions and one simile, but first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy Anubha and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. The cat agrees. The simile is about is from the Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here, is from the 35th book of Vakka, on the census of the Samyutta Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, which I can recommend a lot, and it's Sutta Thread Speech number 228. It's called the Ocean. There's two of them. And so the Buddha said like this, that the normal uninstructed worldling, when he speaks about the ocean, then it's a thing that's a wide waste, very deep expanse of water. And there are storms and whirls and sharks and dangerous things down there. But this is not the ocean in the speech of the noble ones, of the Buddhas and the Arahants. They know another ocean, and that ocean is called samsara. It's an ocean where the currents, the waves, and the storms, they are composed of sights, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and mental states that all are alluring, tempting, tantalizing, enticing, captivating, addictive, almost impossible to resist. And because these beings with this mind that are deep as the ocean and conscious mind, this consciousness that also are deep, endlessly deep, is sucked into desire for all these currents, wavelets of drifting sense objects that drift by the mind all the time. So therefore the Buddha, he said, these beings from the highest God, from Brahma Deva to kings, presidents, politicians, princes, human beings, animals, and lower beings, they are all entrapped in this ocean. They are a knotted ball of thread. They are completely entangled into each other. So it cannot escape. It cannot escape birth, aging, sickness, and death while plunged down, while swimming around, led about by this current and that current, this sin subject, that sun subject, this addiction, that addiction, this form of clinging, this binding here, this binding there. As long as this mind is enslaved by these sense objects, then it cannot escape. It cannot escape suffering. It cannot reach the other shore, the far shore where the arahants, they have gone up on dry land into deathlessness. There are no currents there drifting by of sense objects, of signs, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and mental states. So this is one ocean. The ocean down there in this ocean, why is this ocean so captivating? Because the ability to see the internal sense sources, there are also six. The ability to see, the ability to hear, the ability to smell, taste, touch, think, and have mental states. This is also this time ocean of suffering, where beings, they are plunged into it. They are submerged into it. They are drowning in it again and again. Because these internal sense sources, these receptors, they get attached to the external sense object that they can sense. And all that diversity, colorful differences and details. So it gets lost, so to speak. The senses get lost in this endless forest, in this endless ocean of sights, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and mental states. Just as little man you see here, he runs through this existence without knowing so, from life to life to life to life. He runs and runs and runs and runs. He keeps running. He has the illusion that he comes somewhere, that there is some development. But actually, he's just running in circles. This circle here, that circle there, that circle there. And because he is catched up by death every time, then this must be characterized as suffering. So, these sense objects, they surges in on the mind with this ability to see, hear, and sense. They flood in over the mind. They overcome the mind again and again. Typically, when you cannot resist some food, or cannot resist a sexual object, or a form of entertainment, or going to a new destination on tourism, or having a new partner, or seeing a new porn movie, or drinking a new form of alcohol, or taking a new kind of drugs, then it's because of this overwhelming of the sense object, this flooding in, this surge of sense objects on the sense sources. So this flooding is basically caused by both the external, six external sense objects, and the six internal sense sources. If one couldn't see, then one would be overwhelmed by visible objects, like for example porn, but also art, visual art, like pictures, images, films, and so on. And similar with the other senses, one would not be overcome by this. They keep stirring up the mind, this perception. Because as soon as there is perception, then there's also feeling. When there's feeling of either pleasure, pain, or neutral feeling, then three things arise, if unaware. If pleasant feeling arises from this sense perception that overwhelms the mind just because it's there, then craving towards the object arises in the mind. Then the mind suffers from this craving. If it's an unpleasant, painful object that arises because of this perception, because of this contact with the object, then craving away from the object, repulsion, overcomes the mind. And therefore, the mind suffers from that. And if it's an either pleasant nor painful feeling that arises because of this sense contact that keeps overwhelming, flooding in, searching in on the mind, then because it's neither pleasure nor pain, then mind wants to neglect it because it wants only pleasure. because it thinks that sense pleasure is the way to lasting happiness. That's of course not the case. Because it wants to neglect the object and find a sensual object that gives pleasure, then ignorance caused by this neglect, because you don't learn the object when you neglect it, huh? So ignorance arises right there. So this means that these three root defilements of greed, hate, and ignorance, they arise because of external sense objects flooding in on the internal sense sources, the ability to see, hear, and so on. So perception arises. When there's contact perception, then feeling arises. When there's feeling and there's no awareness, then greed, hate, and ignorance grow automatically. Seen from a large perspective, it's like a fly, you know. It goes down the bottle because there's sugar, sweet sugar water on the bottom. And then it buzzes around, cannot come out of the bottle. It sees the bottle as happiness, even though it dies down there within 24 hours. If you look down such bottles next day, then the fly is dead. Then it's in another bottle. And so it goes on from life to life. Same thing with us. There are 31 levels of existence. Not all of them are pleasant. There comes a small film of samsara right here.
Tanha paschaya upadana.
so much about this time ocean of suffering, of sensing, and being trapped in this external sense object, meeting the internal sense sources, the eye, the ear, and so forth. We go to the questions. Question number 193. While dying Anagarika Dhammapala, which you see here, a lay Buddhist reformer here in early Sri Lanka, modern times, he said, let me be reborn again 25 times to share the Buddha Dhamma. And the question is here, are such wishes advantageous and effective? First we can speak about, are they effective? Anagarika Dhammapala, he did a lot of good things. If you have the karma and you dedicate, have a wish, and the karma corresponds to the wish, then in general they are effective, these wishes. Are such wishes advantageous? Yes and no. Is it ideal? No. The ideal case would be if Anagarika Dhammapala, he said to himself, for this good I've done in this life, I promoted the Dhamma here in Sri Lanka and in the world, let me never be reborn again. Let me attain Nirvana. So one can see this kind of like a skimp that he wants to run 24 times more in the cycle to preach the Dhamma. But there might be in the back of his head some fear, both of Nirvana and also some craving, clinging left for the world. And that's why he say, this 25 times. The ideal case, you can say, is better than he has said to himself, let me come back to to come back to the world and be a king or president or famous person 25 times. It's better than that. Yes, so far so good. But is it the ideal? Is it the perfect wish? No, it's not. It's not. It's in between. It's good, but it's not perfect. Question B. Are there Buddhas that arise on other planets, or is there some special aspect to Earth? The Buddha himself said that there were innumerous world systems, Chakravala, which could possibly be translated to galaxies, but could also be another system of planets. And there in each world system, there are these 31 levels of existence, and they are in such a pancake of 31 levels of existence. Is it this local world system, whatever it may be, galaxy or solar system or whatever it may be, then there can only arise one Buddha at a time in such system. So there are numerous other world systems that have their particular Buddhas, which we don't know anything about. But the Buddha, he knew. Question number 194. Is Mahatma Gandhi a bodhisattva? I don't know, to be honest. His way of life and his putting emphasis on non-violence and also his self-sacrifice could point in that direction. But so could also for Jesus and for Mother Teresa and similar beings, that they are bodhisattvas, and many others also that are not known, not very well known. But it's difficult to say, and I don't know. Could be. B, what is your opinion about Mahatma Gandhi and the movie about his life? I saw the movie about his life very early, I think in my 20s, and I was very impressed with it. I think I shed tears, actually, from seeing it. But I think it was Ben Kingsley who played Mahatma Gandhi at that time. And the numerous times he went into starvation, and he was imprisoned a lot, doing all these riots and ethnic unrest in India during the late colonial times. But I think his effort was very impressive, because he more or less was a dominant figure for India to gain its freedom from English colonialism. So I promote him some places in my website. However, every time I send an email out where there is a picture of Mahatma Gandhi, then I'm asked by some Indians, some people from India, that I not do this because in India he's a very controversial person for two reasons. First of all, because he was a Hindu. He was not a Buddhist. He liked Buddhism very much and commended Buddhism very much, but he remained a Hindu all his life. And secondly, because he accepted the caste system. And this, especially the low caste people, the Dalits in India, which are major, there's several hundred millions of them. I don't know exactly how many. I guess around 250, maybe 300, maybe 400 million low caste people. They are not unambiguously pro-Mahatma Gandhi, while India as such see him as a historical figure. So for some people, he's a controversial person. But I have to say, I have never met Mahatma Gandhi myself. So I don't know him personally. And film or not, and historical events or not, one doesn't know in his entire life. The Buddha say, before you can evaluate a person, then you should live with him for 6 months in his the house where he lives. Then you know his secrets also. And that only if you're an intelligent person, you have a chance to evaluate this person as he really is, to get a true evaluation. So in general, I would say, most of all, because of his emphasis on nonviolence and his self-sacrifice, long life self-sacrifice, and fighting for the poor people, also in South Africa, before he came to India, as a lawyer, then my impression of him is very positive. But again, I don't know him personally. I don't know him personally. But as I said, the movie moved me a lot and was formative for me in my late youth, in my early 20s, to the extent that I shed tears. Question 195. Is garden Buddha statues a good idea? Well, yes and no. Depends upon the attitude of those who put it there and how they behave according to it. If it's a part of a garden decoration, then it's not good. Should not be treated as a decoration. Because it's not something that, because of the sensuality and the entrapment of sensuality, then it's kind of like a crime to use a Buddha statue as a sensual pleasure decoration of your garden. So it should be used as a something in connection with a temple or an altar or a sacred place or a holy place. And in there, this can't be in a garden, can't be in a forest very well, actually, because the Buddha, he stayed out at half of his life and recommended staying out, and gave special privileges to the forest monks, the Aranyavasin forest monks, that has gone and stay remotely in the forest, just like I do and have done now for 15 years. So he praised that a lot. So Buddha statues can be outside. It's not about that. You can put it under a roof probably. But if it can't take the rain, if it's brass, then it can also be outside, or stone can also be outside without a roof. However, one important feature is that it should be higher. So the eyes of the Buddha statue should be higher than your eyes when you stand up. So this must never be so that the spectator, they're looking down, because that's as reckoned as disrespectful, to look down on the Buddha. Whether he's standing up or sit down, then his eyes should be higher, on a higher level than any of the spectator's eyes. So put on some kind of pedestal or a small hill or some stones or whatever. But then it can be done. If it's treated with respect, then it can be in a garden. And this is in several gardens in Asia. There are several statues outside of the Buddha in Asia, both with a roof and without a roof. So it depends not so much about the statue. It depends upon the attitude of the spectator and how it's placed. It should always be placed higher than the spectators. Then it's okay. High location and not used as a decoration. B. What is the difference between giving to a Buddha statue and personally to a Buddha? Yes, giving to a Buddha statue There you give to an effigy. It still have some address, you can say, because it points to a specific individuality that has a consciousness. And this consciousness that is still around, the probability effects of that is still around. So the address there you are kind of like giving to is still there. However, the strength of the connection, the coupling between the address and thereby the probability effect, that is enormous in the case of a Sammasambuddha, is less than if it's a statue that's the address. So it's, you can say, it's a matter of coherence of waves. We can also say it's kind of like a thread or a link. The connection there can have different strengths. And the more personal it is, the better it is. The better it is, of course, to give to a Sammasambuddha while he's still alive. If he's not alive, then to give to an Arahant or to a Pachekabuddha. If they are not alive, then to an Arahant. If they are not alive, then to a noble of any type, even a stream entra. Gives is, we say, the giving give to a stream entra, a sotapanna. The merit is asankhya, is incalculable. You cannot calculate it on your calculator. But it's difficult to say who is a stream entrant. If you're not a stream entrant yourself, you cannot evaluate who is a stream entrant. But a good rule of thumb is that those who say they are not. And in particular, if it's monks who says it, because it's forbidden for a monk by rule of the Buddha to say, to explain any of his attainments. So if it's a monk that says they are stream entrant, whether Mahayana or Hinayana, then you can exclude that they are clean monks first, and then they are stream entrant secondly. So either they are deliberately lying, or they have deceived themselves and now try to deceive others also. So it's a difficult case, actually, to find a stream entrant to give to. But they're still around. They're still around. Fair shot in the world, I guess there is something between 20 and 60 in that order. So fairly rare, because they're spread out in all the Buddhist countries and can be abroad also. Fairly rare. Can be both laymen and monks and nuns. Usually they don't do much about themselves because they have lost a lot of pride. They're not proud of themselves, so they don't go around and tell about it. But in short, the difference between giving to the real person, noble or not, or an effigy, is the strength of the connection, which can be a huge strength, direct. Then the coupling between the probability effect, which is connected with the consciousness, individual consciousness of the receptor, that is coupled directly to the donor. While if it's kind of like giving to a jump over link, which is isn't an effigy, there the effigy is in between. You give to the effigy is linked to the individuality, non-local both in time and space, then it's kind of like weaker, weaker and weaker and weaker. But still there is effect, still there's effect. Again, from a quantum mechanical point of view, it's a matter of about coherence. How much the wave phenomena that your consciousness is swinging with is going to swing with the consciousness of the Buddha 2,500 years ago. Again, it's worth noticing that these wave phenomena are non-local in time and space. They do not respect time, they do not respect space. But they can't be coupled. This means that they start to swing together. And that as one of these components, this swinging is a measure of probability, where the height of the wave is the square of the probability. Then if your small consciousness wave become connected with a wave of this size, or 100 meters size, or 100 kilometers size, as a Sammasambuddha, and thereby this orthogonal probability also is very large, then even a small connection between this very large probability effect and this consciousness over here, that can have a very large effect. Very large effect. Now I regard it most meritorious to give to the Lord Buddha's tooth inside candy here, or to some of the other relics that are here on Sri Lanka. There's some splinters of the collarbone, this collarbone, and there's some hairs also. Similarly, there are genuine relics in Burma, and there are genuine relics in India. And this is because these objects are connected with a even stronger than an effigy. They would be, if the effigy is here and the real person is here, then any part of the body will be something in between here, connected with this address of this very, very large probability consciousness double wave system that, again, is non-local in space and non-temporal in time. It is everywhere existent at all times. And so also goes for your experiences. When you have died, and when you remember them at your moment of enlightenment, then it's not the same brain. So they're stored in the brain. They're stored outside here, everywhere. So all information of past events is still here, present here, and can be read if you have the ability to read at all frequencies of this probability consciousness wave that is a double wave system that induces each other. I hope this make this question clear. Then I'd like to say thank you for all the donors. We are in the regarding building the meditation pavilion for visiting meditators. Then we are carrying up sand up here in 4,000 feet elevation, and it's a major job. And they will carry up iron rods and then cement, and then we'll start building the foundation and the pillars. And when we have the pillars, we'll put on the roof. But I will give some, I'll make some videos little by little as when the project goes on. But I'm very happy about it because many meditators can sit there, around 40 meditators. And of course, if you or anybody else in the future would like to come and visit, then you're welcome to come by. There are several hotels, small hotels here nearby, where one can live for shorter, longer time. And I also have some very primitive, but it do the job, guest rooms up here on the hill. Last but not least, thank you for your attention, consideration, generosity, and kindness. Namo Tasso Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. May all beings, may they become thus happy by knowing and rejoicing in exactly this fact. Thank you, and have a nice and noble day.
Friends, the Four Noble Truths, Chatari Arya Satyani, which is the very core of Buddhism, are the following. 1. All this and such is suffering, dukkha. 2. Craving is the cause of suffering, dukkha, samudaya. 3. Absence of craving is the end of suffering, dukkha nirodho. 4. The Noble Eightfold Way leads to the end of suffering, dukkha, niruddha, kamani, patibhaga. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nibbana is simply this. Right view, sammatitti. Right motivation, sammasankappa. Right speech, sammavacca. Right action, sammakamanta. Right livelihood, sammajiva. Right effort, sammavacama. Right awareness, sammasati. And right concentration, sammasamadhi. But what is right view? What is this initiating and thus crucial right view? Right view is threefold. One, right view is of ownership of karma, like this. All beings are owners of the karma, inherit the karma, are born of the karma, are created by the karma, are linked to the karma, and any intentional action, any karma they do, whether good or bad, the effects of that will be theirs only. Follow him like a shadow that never leaves. This is right view. 2. Right view of the 10th phenomena is like this. Giving alms has good future effects. Any self-sacrifice results in pleasure. Small gifts and donations are also advantageous. There is resulting fruition thus of any good and any bad behavior. There is moral, ethical efficacy of any relation to mother and father. There is this world, and there are other dimensions, other worlds. There are beings who are spontaneously and instantaneously reborn. There exists good and pure recluses and monks in this world, who by having followed the right method of practice, themselves, by their own superhuman abilities, have directly experienced these other worlds, and who explain them and thereby make them known here. This is right view, too. 3. Right view of the Four Noble Truths. Right view of this is suffering. Right view of craving is the cause of suffering. Right view of absence of craving is the end of suffering. Right view of the Noble Eightfold Way leading to the end of suffering. This too is right view. And for further study on right view, Majjhima Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, number 9, is Sammaditti Sutta, the discourse on right view. This and such is right view, Sammaditti. Thank you for your keen attention, and have a nice day.